talk to you.
Recorded live.
All right, I'm Evan Jensen. Welcome to Beyond Reality Paranormal Talk Radio, your finest in the paranormal. With us today is Kay Griffin, which is the host of Beyond Reality Paranormal Talk Radio. Jan Reynolds is also the other host, but is not with us today. Today was a day that we had scheduled two fairly high-profile guests, Bill Bean, author of Dark Force and Paranormal Celebrity. Also, we had scheduled Ben Hanson of Fact or Fake off the Sci-Fi Channel. As of now, it's 3:13 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 13 minutes past the hour. We have not heard from either guest. Hoping everything is well with them too. But as they say, in the show business, the show must go on. So with that said, let's welcome Kelly to the show. Kelly, welcome. Welcome to Beyond Reality Paranormal Talk Radio.
Hi, Evan. Thanks for having me.
You know, you're part of the show.
Right,
it is what it is. And I know that you went through a great deal to juggle your time today with your kids and being away from the show and still found the time to call in. I know you just had a cell phone mishap the other night, and you're still with us, and we really greatly appreciate this. It shows dedication and so forth, and it's really a pleasure always to have you on board with us.
Thanks. You know what? You can do a show from the ballpark. That's fine.
Yeah.
It'll still be
show
fine.
Show from the ballpark, and you're going to make it work. That's amazing. I just got confirmation that legendary James Hershey, co-author, is going to be with us. And my dog is ready to be barking because I've got some serious paranormal activity going on in the house that we can't explain. You know, continual knocking on their doors and there's nobody, you know, all that. And so they're going to be barking, and that I cannot stop. Well, I might. If I get mad enough, I'll have the house blessed and whatever else it takes. But as you can tell, you can hear the noise and so on. So that's just maybe there's something out there that doesn't want our shows to continue here for a while or whatever. Again, we've dealt with this before several times. But the activity has picked up, and we just kind of wonder why.
Yeah, it has. And if you know, it seems like it's always on show day for you.
It is always on a show day, and it's very interesting to think, you know, what is it? Why is it that there's something supernatural out there that might be wanting us to not do our shows? What reason is that? We don't get into a cult mess or, you know, we don't support demonic type stuff or anything really creepy, you know what I mean? Sometimes you get connected psychologically, inadvertently, whatever, and so you have to wonder, you know? It could be the spirit of worse themselves.
You know, a lot of times, I think, and especially now, there's like a spiritual warfare all over the world, good versus evil. And I think anytime you try to do something good, that you're always going to have that opposing force, no matter what. So let's just say, let's hope that's what it is. we're just trying to do good, and you know, evil doesn't like that. So,
no, it doesn't.
But you know what they say.
It's always going to battle. Always a battle between the good and the evil and so forth, and forces that we can't really comprehend. Just amazing. I want to give a special shout-out and put Deborah Fawcett on the spot. It's her birthday today. So I just want to send a shout-out to Deborah, who's actually with us on in queue. We're going to have her on a little bit to promote some stuff. And, you know, just wishing her a very happy birthday. And for people that are listening, they can go in and plaster her wall with happy birthday. And I always like the memes, you know, that show you, like, getting really old and stuff like that. That's always a good slap to somebody having a birthday. Hey, you're older. Run into that and tease them a little bit. That's what birthdays are really about when you get older. I do believe we have James Hershey, Jr., who are also with us. James, are you in, too?
Yeah, I'm here, brother.
All right. So, we got James. He's been very helpful for us. He's been very dedicated to coming on. Again, thanks, James. You know, when it really sucks, dude, and you're going to find out, you know, with your show that you're doing, that sometimes when you have guests that are supposed to come on when they're supposed to, they don't do that, and it leaves you in a bind, and you will not know until you go live. And once you experience some of that fun stuff, hopefully it won't happen, but in the business it does.
Yeah, it happens, but we have such winning personalities, I'm sure we can carry the day.
Yeah, exactly. The show goes on, man, in show business, it never stops. Oh, I gave it some thought, you know, I'm like, I could end this, you know, and not have to do it. Then I'm like, no, we're not going to do it. You know, we schedule those people that are tuned in via their iPhones and PCs here, so, you know, let the show happen. And the show is what you make of it. So, with that said, in the past, I've been pretty rude and vocal. You know, when somebody doesn't show up, I'm like, you know what, dude, but nah. Whatever, people have their own reasons. They may got stuck in traffic, maybe having a bad hair day. Hell, they may have gotten drunk. I don't know. Whatever the reasons are, it's theirs, and the show must go on. So that leaves me. What shall we talk about? Can we change the topics? You know, all that. So, and this is why I enjoy having an open mic type of show. You don't know the exact direction of the topics or where the show is going to go, but it's a free mic, and people can pretty much say whatever they feel like sharing. So that's what kind of show this is going to be, today. So, with that said, who wants to join? You know, who wants to come in first here? Who wants to join in? James, Kelly, Deborah. Deborah's got a new event, and if she's listening, she can join in soon here and share. There was something about a movie. Kelly, what was that all about?
I'm sorry, you were cutting out at the last part. What was that? What was the question?
Question was about Deborah Fawcett. She was something about a movie I saw on a post.
A movie. I'm sorry, Ev, I don't know. A movie. Oh, that Deborah's doing.
Yeah.
She's got, I'm sorry. She's got Mr. Rush. I don't know if you've heard of him. He does some filming, and he has a web series. And they filmed, the second episode is going to be at her jail, actually. They've already done the filming. It's supposed to be really, really interesting. And I think that since I have been there, it's going to be even more interesting to watch. I mean, I like going to see on the big screen.
Yeah. Very cool. I know Deborah said she's going to be calling in, too, here.
Yeah, she is supposed to be here in a few minutes, but, you know, that jail is one of the most haunted places I've ever been in. I've been in a few, so I think that's going to make a great, you know, a great series. So I'm really excited to see that.
Hello. Hello.
Hello. Is this you, Deborah?
This is me.
Okay. So yeah, tell me what's going on there with that. Kelly was just speaking about.
That's exciting. Russell Rush is a San Antonio radio personality at Mix 96.1 iHeart Radio in San Antonio. He created the Emmy-winning web series, The Russell Rush Haunted Tour. This is their ninth season. He chooses a few locations with interesting histories, interesting haunted claims, and shoots documentaries that are usually an hour long. Brings in a top-notch film crew, great paranormal investigative team, and season 9 starts this Thursday on the 13th. I think their first episode is the Aztec Theater in San Antonio. The following Thursday on the 20th, they'll be doing the haunted old Lavaca County Jail, which y'all are familiar with.
Yeah.
Third week on the 20th, I believe is, the 27th, is a private ranch that they did somewhere that I don't really have any of the details on. But they do some great shows. All their shows are broadcast through RussellRushHauntedTour.com, YouTube, available later on demand. It's all Clear Channel Media stuff. But they've done some fabulous locations, and all their previous episodes are online for people to go look at. They had a great time at the jail. I think it's going to be a great show. We're going to actually go watch it live with him on the 20th at the iHeart Studio there in San Antonio in their media room. And we're going to do an online call-in show afterwards. We're excited about it and going to get us a lot more attention, I believe.
Oh, I think that any time you promote stuff like that out there and you get it out there, yeah, it's good. It's good for business, and it's a nice way to, you know, get stuff out there for your event and so forth.
Oh yeah, we're always all about promoting the jail. I mean, it's already booking up for the fall, and we've got some more filming deals that are going to be happening. A local news station is going to come out and fill a segment for Halloween. A lot of fun things coming up. We just had our grand opening Chamber of Commerce ribbon cutting ceremony to promote it more to the community, more from a historical standpoint. But doing those historic little tours with them, you know, about every eighth person would pull me aside and want to know about the paranormal part of it.
I can't imagine why they wouldn't. You know, I want to go there. I want to spend the night there. Maybe James and I
want you to come
go there and
spend the night. Absolutely. Kelly wants you to come especially. She's she can show you the ropes as a former prisoner.
That's right.
She knows what it takes to get by and survive there in that jail.
I wish there were historical places like that where people took invested interest and really maintained them and you know, preserved history like you've done. It's just an amazing thing, really.
Yeah, I mean, it's such a historical place to hang on to, and
yeah,
I'm totally in love with it, and I'll probably be there forever now. I'll probably be haunting it after I die. I just can't imagine not being there.
Well, I'm going to let James join in here a little bit and let him talk. I know I was just on a show the other day, and Revolution Radio host James Hershey and horror author James Hershey, Jr. James, welcome to Beyond Reality Paranormal Talk Radio. It's a pleasure having you today as well.
Thank you, brother. And I want to tell you, for all the audience, Evan was on my show last night, and we discussed White-Eyed Demons and the Buell case and stuff like that. And already today, just the buzz is incredible about the show. People are fired up about this White-Eyed Demon thing. And they are just hungry, hungry, hungry for more, brother.
Yeah, I appreciate that. You know, the topic itself, White-Eyed Demons, you know, I know it presents a lot of interest. And again, there are some TV shows, you know, where these White-Eyed Demons is the principal thing, you know. And again, that's Hollywood, and hopefully they won't misconstrue what the topic really is about. You know, we're talking about something demonic, something that don't have form, something that doesn't have a body. We're talking about the supernatural. We're not talking about bloodthirsty, you know, demon vampires, or, you know, that might be a whole different thing, right?
Yeah, you know how Hollywood is, brother. It takes like a little tiny nugget of truth, and then it expands it into this big ball of BS. It's entertaining, but it's not very informative sometimes. But the nugget of truth is what we're really after. And my audience is just excited because it's something that they had barely ever heard of before. And, I mean, you really lit a firestorm in it, brother.
Yeah, it's something that should be explored and researched and so forth, you know. So, yeah, it is what it is. So, other than that, I think that if you research it more, you'll find things that are very interesting. And there are some definite haunted stories out there from people that have been written about it, but they're not calling it white-eyed demons or, you know, white-eyed kids or white-eyed children or whatever. They don't really have names for it, just that the incidents have happened and so forth. So the concept is really fascinating within itself.
Have you ever done any articles on it in the Herald? Because that might be a really cool idea to start documenting these cases and doing articles in the Paranormal Herald about it.
Yeah, I thought about that. I just didn't really alienate the Herald that way, but there are, yeah, I've got a write-up that I was going to put in there about it. There might be one article that was kind of brief about it, and they got a lot of responses, and I should do a follow-up on that and actually include the actual stories. I've got them on my external hard drive, so I could put all the stories that I did receive in there. Not all of them, because I received a lot, but some main ones, and some very interesting facts were the locations where I was able to map out formed this really weird area. You know how like the Bermuda Triangle has an area on a map and it makes an emblem or a symbol, right? Well, these sightings that I put flags up on the computer, on this program, it pinpointed the sighting, and it just kind of, it was a weird simulation. It was just weird. I can show like pictures of that and you know, things like that. So, other than that, yeah, that's a good idea. And, you know, and I welcome anybody has any other stories that they may have had encounters or any of that, yeah, bring it to our attention, you know, and we'll take a look and read them and put them also in with the rest of the stories that we have already.
Yeah, because it's a rare opportunity in the paranormal field where you have something that's not only intriguing and, yeah, and exciting to study, but also that there's not a whole lot known about. So it's really an open slate to where you can really dive in there and figure this thing out. And I think it would be great for a whole series of articles and maybe even a documentary or two once we get enough information about it and really try to get that evidence down and get it put out so that people can see. Because I've noticed the more articles you write on things and the more evidence you gather, the more evidence seems to come in. So, I mean, we have an opportunity here to learn a hell of a lot about something that we don't know a whole lot about, which is always exciting.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's it. Yeah, you're right. I want to talk about something that is a little concerning. The last couple of days, we've had some weird activity go on here, and it's what I will call some kind of, you know, residual haunting knocking on the outside of our door and the inside has been going on sporadically, both day and night. Something will be knocking on the door. I go to answer the door. The dogs are all barking, nobody home. And I'm talking within a second after the knock. I'm like, okay, who's there? I go to work, nobody. And so, you know, you just got to wonder. So that's been going on off and on, both, like I say, early in the morning, like 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning, 1 in the morning, and even during the day in the mid-afternoon. So we're kind of wondering, taking notice, something's going on again, and so that's been going on. Hopefully we won't get any knocking on the show today. We had one earlier, and luck, again, there was nothing. Pretty weird, but it is what it is. So we do have with us, we have Dr. Rita, that had called in, so I'm going to ask her to come on in, Q here, and let's welcome also Dr. Rita. Dr. Rita, how are you? Welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me back on. Always nice to hang out with you guys.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. It's always a pleasure having you on. We love having you on, and you're becoming one of us, I think. And we kind of just, I didn't really give you a very good heads up when you were on, and so I apologize for that. Been a little baffled by the beer thing going on and just getting pounded on the websites from onlookers and curious people and things like that. So it's kept me a little too busy, and we'll get right back into programming here after my little vacation here in a few days and get back up to speed. So it's Halloween coming up here. We're on the 11th, so it sounds like it's a ways away, but it's not. So do you have any major plans for Halloween? Are you planning events or any major plans for the Halloween month?
I have a couple of events I'll be speaking at. Well, no. One I'll be speaking at. The other one, I'm just going to hang out. You know, Halloween is not my big holiday. So I tend to hide from the trick-or-treaters. Is that bad or what?
Nobody can blame
you. No, I, you know, It'll be a little weird because last year we went live, I had like 3 trick-or-treaters. What a bummer. The year before that, I had like 120. The year before that, we only had a few, and the year before that, we had many. I try to, may want to hide this Halloween too. Especially if a bunch of damn calls knock on my door, I'm not answering.
Well,
yeah.
I mean, I haven't had very good success having kids come to the door, so that's part of it, why I have just changed, mode. But it, makes my animals crazy, and, thus makes me crazy with them barking, so.
Yeah, I know.
Especially, Evan, you were talking about the clown thing.
Our
neighborhood is always hit really, really hard. You can't even get into your own house after a certain time because it's just, it's that neighborhood that there's a lot of kids, and so everybody comes, and it'll go on for hours and hours. But I was, talking to my family yesterday, and I was thinking, with all this clown stuff, I'm not sure that I even want to do that this year.
You're not sure you want to open your door, right?
Right. And if you're a clown, you're definitely not getting candy. I'm sorry. they're a little nervous.
You're getting buckshot, right, Kelly?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I know everybody likes a little clown around once in a while, but damn them clowns.
I know.
See, I live way up in the mountains, man, so, I don't have trick-or-treaters here. Nobody comes here because I'm way up in the mountains. So if you climb the mountain through the scary woods to get to my house, then I guess you earned a Snickers bar or something because it's not an easy trip.
Hey, wait a minute. James, how tall are you?
I am 6'4", 300 pounds.
That's why you don't have any damn trick-or-treaters.
I'm a scary fella.
But see, if they came to my house and I had to do an impromptu Halloween thing, I'd be like, here's some beans, maybe some crackers, or a slice of bread. How about mayonnaise? I mean, it's pretty sad. It's a sad state of affairs.
Well, I know my dogs are ready to go. I mean, my one little chihuahua, not mine, my daughter's little chihuahua, and the wiener dog puppy has got a little skeleton costume that it'll be wearing. It's wearing now, I think. And my dog's got like a Batman deal she's going to wear. But I don't know if anybody else is ready or not. I don't know. But
what do y'all think is going on with this clown thing, really? I mean, it's... Why are people doing this? Are they just doing the copycat, dark things? Is it the veil thinning and everybody just getting evil? I don't know. I can't figure it out.
It's too widespread, to be like a copycat thing. It's just too widespread. It reminds me, and like Evan said yesterday on the show, it's one of those black helicopter moments. It reminds me of like some kind of psyops or something going on because it's like starting to be everywhere. And it's the dumbest damn thing. There's no reason for it. I mean, who are you supposed to be scaring? It just doesn't make any sense. But all of a sudden, they're just showing up everywhere, and that's all that people are talking about anymore. So it makes me wonder what's going on that they're trying to distract us from,
Yeah. Yeah, I do. It's exactly, I never dressed up as some horrific monster-looking thing. I dressed up like... I don't know, one time I went as Father Time, with a robe. We were a poor family. We didn't have money to go buy costumes and stuff. I remember Mom saying, I'll make you a costume that'll be really cool. And she took an old white sheet, and made a costume with it, and made it to look like a toga and all that, and then she made a beard out of cotton, and she did a pretty good job, and used the lining for the beard from an old mop, the inside of the type of mops you use that have long, strangly like hair fibers, and made a beard and a mustache, and she went out and found an old stick, and she actually would whittle this thing and made it like a walking stick, That was a bomb. That costume rocked, man. I remember that costume. I wish I had that. It was pretty cool. Pretty cool concept, too. So I didn't dress as creepy things, and I never got that, you know. You know, be creative. Make something. Don't go out and buy something to scare people when you can make your own stuff. Cheap, too.
And I always thought that, like, dress up for work thing was silly, too, that they do, like, in a lot of jobs. Like, when I used to work, before I started writing and all this stuff and doing radio, every Halloween at work, it would be like, you know, come to work in a costume day, you know what I mean, where you could wear a weird costume or a freaky costume or whatever you want to do, and then come to work. But I learned that not every costume is acceptable. For example, if you dress as a nudist and come to work, then you're not going to have to work that day or as many days afterwards.
Yeah. I had to step outside because somebody knocking on my damn door again. There ain't nobody there. Oh, that's frustrating. Can you imagine being at home and something knocking on your door whenever it feels like it, all hours of the day and night? Is that weird or what?
Well, you know, it kind of depends on who you are. I mean, in my house, I would think that was kind of normal, but...
Yeah, but does it have to do it, like, during my radio shows? Can I get a break, please?
But, you know, if knocking is the only thing you have going on, I mean, where I live, there's the train, there's the police and fire engines and ambulances that go down the street right next to me, and then in the summer, there are the cicada bugs, which are loud. And sometimes, you know, when I'm on air, I'll get the triple whammy. I'll get the train, the cicada bugs, and the fire department, you know, going down the street. So... be happy with them just knocking on your door.
Yeah, those cicadas can be rough, man.
Because they might all sing in unison, too, and it makes it, like, super, super loud.
I suppose. But for some reason, my little Chihuahua and Wiener Dog puppy is just like a damn radar antenna. I have never seen anything like it. I mean, it knows that's going to happen. She starts barking, and then here comes the knock. What the hell? That's been intuitive like I've never seen before.
Animals can pick up on that. They really can. And, you know, my house is extremely haunted, as I've told you. We live on Indian burial ground. And, you know, the dogs will literally just look up, you know, into a corner and bark at the air, at nothing. So they have that, you know, they have that sixth sense, and they know. You know, I always pay attention to them for sure. Them and the kids and the baby.
Yeah, you're right about that because I can remember living with my mom. I was a mama's boy. Oh, boy, I can't believe I said that for the record. Yeah, I was still living. I was young, though, you know, a teenager. Well, not teenager. Yeah, I was 18. Okay, so I lived with my mom, and when my grandfather used to be a winemaker. He would make homemade wine. He put it in, like, 55-gallon, you know, barrels and drums, and he'd have wine brewing everywhere. And that was his thing. He'd be down there all hours of the day and night, checking on his wine, doing his thing. And when he died, my German Shepherd, in the middle of the night, would whine to go downstairs, and she'd always sit at the exact same spot where my grandfather had his winemaking set up and everything. She'd just sit there. And she'd sit there, and you know, I watched her several times, and I remember doing this. It was like he was petting her, and she was getting petted while he was there. She was there watching him do whatever it was he was doing, and I just found it just really, really cool. And it wasn't like she, you know, it wasn't like she was just sitting down there looking at a mouse or something. It was clear and evident that something was down there, and she was being petted, you know, because she'd move her head and. You know, when you pet a dog, what they do, and that's what she would do. And she would stay down there for about 2 hours or so, and then she whined and wanted to come back upstairs again. This was a nightly thing. So, yeah, I always believed that she was seeing the image of my grandfather and getting attention that way. And this went on for many, many years until finally she died and got old and you know. So, yeah, I've seen how, you know, animals can be intuitive in that respect.
I find it so interesting, too. Have you noticed, and maybe one of you could explain this to me, that I've noticed that as, you know, young children, babies and animals,
are very, you know, they're very, very sensitive to that energy. And then we become grown up. And then as you age, like, for, you know, people that you hear the stories in nursing homes and things, that they begin to see them again. They begin to see their loved ones coming for them. But there's like this period where we're here and we have to be grown ups and go to work. And we, I don't know if it's because our brains are different, but then, you know, we're not as influenced by them. We're not as sensitive to them. And, you know, even on a near-death experience that I had, I've talked about this many times, I sat up straight and saw one of my loved ones coming for me. So it's like you start out with it, the animal keep it, and then in the end we get it again. That's just fascinating to me.
Yeah, it is.
I think it has a lot to do with faith. You know what I mean? And I don't mean just faith in a religious sense. I mean just belief. I mean, if you look in the Bible, Jesus talks about if you have the faith of a mustard seed, you can move mountains. I think faith in the spiritual realm plays a huge role. And when you're really young, you believe anything's possible. You know what I mean? You have that faith. You have that belief that extraordinary things can happen. As you get older, you kind of lose that, and you become jaded and more realistic. And then when you get older and you're looking at your own mortality, you're kind of – you're filled with that faith again of possibility of heaven or whatever it is, or, you know, something that goes beyond this, seeing your relatives again. So that faith and that belief returns. And I think that has a lot to do with being able to see things, you know?
But I think that in society, we're told it's not there. It's invisible, you know, you're seeing things, you know. I mean, we're just totally programmed. And I feel like children that are brought up in the culture of, you know, I saw grandma at the foot of my bed, you know, the parents supporting that and supporting their intuitiveness versus saying, go back to sleep, you know, it was your imagination, fosters that ability in them, where so many of us, it's just been turned off, you know, because we don't trust it, we don't honor it. And, you know, when I teach people how to develop their psychic abilities, that's what I tell them. It's like, I'm not teaching you how to be psychic. I'm just teaching you how to tap into what you already have. But we're not taught that. We're taught that, you know, it's a coincidence. It's just some weird thing, which I don't really understand the mentality around that. You know, why as a culture we do that, you know?
Religions, you know. I grew up Southern Baptist. My grandpa was a preacher, and there were just things you didn't talk about. You know, I had a make-believe friend, and I had him for years. We had to set the table for him. I talked to him. And, you know, living with my grandpa and my mama, you know, they would always say, yeah, it's just it's a make-believe friend. It's your imagination. And then, of course, there comes Santa Claus. Oh, it's not magical after all. We lied. And so I think you're right. Once you get to a point, you kind of become, you're not open to it anymore, open to that, the magic and mystical, and God forbid, we, you know, speak of ghosts. So they still don't like me speaking about it, but guess what? It's too late.
And I think that was a very important point that was made, that when she said she doesn't teach people to be psychic, she teaches them how to believe in their own abilities, basically. And that's a very, very, very valid point, because I think all of us have that ability inside of us. All of us have the capability to do extraordinary things. We just have to believe that it's possible. We just have to suspend disbelief and ignore everything that society has told us and not worry about looking foolish and just go with our gifts, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Couldn't agree with you more.
And like the children, you know, my daughter had before, James, she looked at me like I had three heads when I told her that not everyone can see spirits, because I was saving one time, and she said, you know, be sure and tell the little girl, I told her this before, the little girl in my corner that has this low ponytail that goes down that she can stay. And I said, that's how I kind of knew. And she said, oh, tell the one on the stairs, the scary one, that he needs to go. And she really believed that we all could do that, that everybody could see. So I took her to a mediumship class, and she really just, I thought she was going to be shy, but she just got right in there with them. And it was so rewarding to see that, you know, to see her expressing that and not being ashamed of it.
Yeah. Well, I do believe here, assuming everything goes well, Bill Bean should be calling in at 4 o'clock, so let's hope for Bill Bean to call in too, and his story, and the author of a book about Dark Forest, and Dark Forest is where we'll be hopefully hearing from Bill. For those that are messaging me and they're wanting to know why Ben Hanson of Fact or Fake didn't show up, and to be honest, I have no idea. Other than he didn't appear at his scheduled time, or I've had no responses in response to him. Hoping that all is well with him on that. Things happen, as we all know, although it can be discouraging. So I just wanted to send that out for people that have tuned in and have messaged me saying, hey, where's Ben? Like they say, who needs Ben Hanson? We've got our own panel. We've got Dr. Rita. We got Deborah Fawcett. We got horror author James Hershey Jr., myself, and Kelly Griffin all in queue at the same time talking and doing a mighty fine job at that. So somebody had messaged me in chat, and they're saying Dr. Rita has authored books on about aliens and extraterrestrials, and so this question is for Dr. Rita. They asked if she would be willing to share her thoughts on aliens and what she has written about. Dr. Rita?
What I've written about is, well, actually, I'm going to frame it in a different way because I have just released a new film called Holy Deception. And what the film looks at is our notion of God. And, you know, because for most people in the Western world, we see God as being this omnipotent being who, you know, blinks his eyes or wiggles his nose or, you know, nods his head and things can manifest into reality. Just boom. I mean, you know, and there are a lot of other concepts, but I'm just going to go with that one for right now. And, but when we look at the mythology from around the world, when they talk about the gods, that's not how they appear. You know, and so my background is not necessarily in contemporary ufology, even though, you know, with my radio show, Just Energy Radio, you know, I've learned a lot over 10 years. Mine is more looking at that question from the historical and the mythological record. What did our ancestors say? Because these were people that didn't, you know, from our viewpoint, didn't know what UFOs were. They didn't have high technology, but they were talking about these things traveling through the sky. They talked about these amazing weapons that the gods have. Now, but think about that a second. So if God is omnipotent and can do anything, then why would God need a weapon? Why would God need a chariot to fly through the sky? And so that's really what this video looks at, and some of my other work looks like E.T. Chronicles, What Myth and Legends Have to Say About Human Origins, is this whole notion of who these people are. Who these individuals are that are quote-unquote gods, but when we look at the gods from a contemporary stance, a technological stance, they're not so godlike.
Interesting, very interesting.
What would you say? I was going to ask a quick question.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was in Mexico when I got a chance to see the Mayan pyramids. Mm-hmm. I was just so blown away by that. They're, you know, they have the light. Yeah, I don't know how many stairs they have, but there's like a million stairs, it seems like, walking up it. But then they had,
I think there were 360 stairs total. You know, and then you divide that by 4, you know, so whatever that is, you know,
Yeah. Back in the day, where they didn't have modern equipment, and they were able to, you know, when the light shines in the hole and tell you exactly what time of day it is, that's just, how did they do that? Did they do that alone? That's a question I've always wondered. Were they alone in doing that, or were they guided by, you know, people that were a little more advanced?
Well, I mean, that's the part that's interesting. When we look at some of these ancient sites, you know, whether it is in Mesoamerica, South America, I mean, you talk about some of those megalithic constructions that are in South America that we can't explain at all. There really isn't any documentation or notation of how they were made or how they were constructed, and so it leaves it just so open and arbitrary. You know, the sites in Mesoamerica, the only thing that I can say about those, I mean, they are engineering marvels. However, when you look at them, they're much made of much smaller stones. You know, they're not like the giant pyramids. They're not like the walls of Sacsayhuaman or the giant stones that are used at Baalbek or Göbekli Tepe or Stonehenge. Everybody knows Stonehenge and those giant stones. You know, it's not made of that same construction, and so that leads me to believe that it's much later, but they still don't chronicle how they were made. And I have yet another but. But they were a very literate society and had thousands upon thousands of books, and when the Spanish went there, they burned them all, and we've been left with four books. And so did they write it down? Did they identify how they were made? Did they talk about their connection with the gods or extraterrestrials? It's possible, but the record's gone, and it's been, you know, pretty much wiped out of their consciousness, which is just sad, heartbreaking.
I think that's one of the great tragedies of history, is that that great library was wiped out. That was, I mean, because I saw a study on the pyramids in Egypt, the Great Pyramid, and the top engineers of today were saying that even with our modern equipment and what we can do now, that it would take us over 600 years to build that thing, like doing the best we possibly could now, because those individual stones are over 10 tons, and how do you move that kind of weight, especially at that time? There had to be some kind of technology that they had that we just don't understand.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, and there's the moving of the stones, and I'm sure everybody can, you know, kind of on some way level visualize the inside of the pyramid, and it has those shafts that go up to the sides. Well, as they're putting these giant stones in, then they have to think about, oh, but we need to cut this shaft that goes up and out the side that's huge. You know, so they figured that it was done as they were constructing it. You know, and in my mind, I just can't even imagine how at that time they could cut the channel out and then put the next stone on, but it needs to be on a certain angle, you know, and have it flow up. And then one of the things that they found was that, you know, they sent a little rover up through there, that there was a door, like a metal door. And so then they, like, drilled through that, and there was a opening there, and then another metal door. And so they have not even, like, sent something up, you know, fiber optic up through that chamber, because it's blocked, but it was blocked at the time they made the pyramids. And they don't know why. You know, if there was a function, if those things opened and closed, we don't know.
The precision that was needed was incredible. I mean, you're talking, when you're making that shape, the math is astounding that you would have to do to figure this out. Because if you're off by just a centimeter, then by the time you get not even close to the top, it's not going to work anymore. It's just not going to hold. I mean, it just blows my mind how so long ago they figured all this stuff out. And I mean, they don't have computers to do the computations. It's amazing to me.
And even getting the materials there, James, that's another big mystery.
because the rocks were quarried from like over 150 miles away is where they got the actual rock to build the pyramid. So then they had to take these 10-ton blocks, and they had to move them over 150 miles to the site to where they're going to be built. And how do you accomplish something like that? I mean, it's astounding.
Mm-hmm. But you're right about the level of precision that's needed. I mean, we look at how things are built today, you know, things that you buy at the store and, you know, there's a seam on it. But you look at it and it's like never straight, or there's a big, you know, gap between one piece and the other piece, houses. I mean, everything we look at today, I mean, the quality is just not there. And you look at something like that where these are, you know, primitives doing it, and many of the stones, you can't put a piece of paper in between or a razor blade. I mean, they are that precise.
Yeah, it's kind of fascinating. I mean, I kind of begin to think, you know, from an engineering standpoint, how technology like that would even have existed back then.
I tend to think that we go through cycles. I think that mankind builds up to a level of amazing technology, and then either something happens cosmically, like an asteroid or something hits, or we blow ourselves up because, you know, we do that. Or some kind of catastrophe happens that wipes us all back to a primitive state again, and then we build up again, and then it happens. I tend to think that there's like cycles that take place throughout time, and we just have no idea. Because, I mean, in the grand scheme of things, we really don't know much about our past. I mean, we know about the very, very recent past, and we don't even get that all the way right. So for scientists and historians to say, this is what happened 10,000 years ago, it's like, well, how the hell do you know what happened 10,000 years ago? You're looking at a drawing on a wall and a piece of bone, and you're trying to make up a whole story about what happened. You really have no idea. For all we know, we could have already been in space before, thousands of years ago. We could have had massive civilizations, and then the whole thing gets wiped out, you know, and now we're doing it again, you know, and it could be a completely different kind of civilization from what we have now. Our technology now is what we've been able to build from what we had, but we could have had much greater things then, and we just have no idea.
Mm-hmm. And I think one of the issues is they don't go far enough back in the archaeological record to really, you know, I get into these little pissing matches with people about when the big flood was, and they're like, well, there isn't any evidence. Well, there's no evidence, you know, at 10,000 years ago or 6,000 years ago for a flood either. And, you know, I suggest that perhaps it was further back in time and perhaps more localized, and that is usually met with skepticism, but it's the only way it really would make any sense at all.
Yeah, we just have to admit the fact that as people that we don't know. I mean, we have good guesses based on evidence, but we really just don't know. I mean, look at like World War II, okay? That to us seems like a real long time ago. There's not even that many people alive today that were there, you know, during that time period. It seems like a long time, but really that wasn't even 100 years. That's nothing geologically, and it's nothing in the span of even recorded history, really. And so there's so much stuff that could have happened that we just have no idea, because like the great library that got burnt, there's that kind of stuff always seems to happen when there's war. We tend to burn our own history and destroy our own records, and it really does a disservice to all mankind.
Yeah, you have a point there.
Well, and one of the other things is that, you know, historians or whoever, you know, are still trying to fit all of humanity into a 6,000, you know, 6,000 BC. That's when everything started, and they don't want to really be open to a concept that it's older. And so even though we found things like Göbekli Tepe that was dated to minimally, you know, they know it was buried at 8,000 BC, 8,000 something BC. So we know it was buried then, but when was it actually constructed? We don't know. And they won't take evidence like that of a high level of technology that was available at that point in time and own it. I don't know any other way to say it. And own it. You know, they just ignore it. It's like, well, yeah, oh, yeah, and there's Göbekli Tepe, and it's kind of in a separate category over there as this weird anomaly versus this continuation of a culture.
People don't really accept evidence, and that even happens today. I mean, it's not just really about the past. It even happens today. Like, I was reading a scientific journal, and I saw that they were doing a dig in New Mexico, and they found in New Mexico human footprints, and over in stone, and over top of the human footprints were dinosaur footprints. Now, to me, that would suggest that humans existed on Earth at the same time as dinosaurs, whether that was in ancient times when dinosaurs were ruling the Earth, or whether some form of dinosaur survived and lived to modern times, I don't know. But that needs to be investigated. But the problem is it doesn't mesh with what science says, and it doesn't mesh with what religion says. So everybody says, okay, that doesn't match anything we know, so we're gonna pretend that doesn't exist anymore. And we do that a lot with a lot of different things, and I think it's really sad because there's so much that we don't know, and there's so much that we can learn. And just because something doesn't mesh with let's say, the theory of evolution or something that science knows, or it doesn't mesh with what the Bible says, doesn't make it not so. I mean, there's no reason it can't exist in all three. You know what I mean? We just need to understand it. And anytime you discount evidence, then you're really doing a disservice to knowledge because you just don't know these things. And that's just the honest-to-God truth.
Right. And it almost seems like, James, it almost seems like the more degrees, you know, that we have, the more educated we get as a society, the less we know, you know, or the less we're willing to know.
Hey, yeah. I just want to check on something. I think I got some messages here. So let me, I think we got Ben Hanson. He called in now. So let's get Ben Hanson on the show, if I can forgive the intrusion here. Ben Hanson, welcome to Beyond Reality Paranormal Talk Radio. It's a pleasure having you today.
Hello, Alvin. Can you hear my call?
Yeah. I'm glad you're here. I was getting a little frantic. I'm like, okay, so I had some friends and some very fine people come and assist me for a while here. And, it's a pleasure to have you on the network.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm not sure if it's going to cut me off. When I called in, it said something about needing credits and that I only had 9 minutes. So I don't know what that means.
Weird.
But,
well, I'll make a good 9 minutes, and if that's the case.
Yeah, it said something about charging my Google account or something. But anyways, I apologize. I don't normally check the my messages. I set it my calendar and my alarm set off that I was supposed to get online, so then I just barely checked them, and here I am.
Yeah, no problem at all. I'm glad you called in. I know you're really busy. I mean, you got a hell of a fan base, and you got projects going, and you're really busy, and so I really do appreciate you taking the time out of your day to spend a little time with us and say hi and so forth, and it's a pleasure having you on. I got to say, dude, you had the number one hit show. I can't think of a better show than Fact or Fate. It is a show that I have come to love. I mean, it's one of the only shows out there where you actually bring the paranormal in so many different aspects. It's amazing, amazing show.
Well, thank you. I really appreciate that. Yeah, we tried to do something that no one else had done before, and I think it was pretty unique.
It is. And, you know, you got me on many of them. I thought, well, that's real, and then it wasn't, and a couple of months ago, that's not real, and then it was. Amazing, yeah, great concept. I wish they'd bring it back, and I wish
if there was a possibility to bring it back, that, you know, that you would have it back. I mean, it's so much better than some of the other shows out there that are just unrealistic in every way, demons in every corner, and just nonsense, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, we had a lot of things going for us on the show because one of the things when I first kind of helped propose the idea was that there's some good shows out there, but a lot of them are just kind of sitting and waiting for things to happen. And
Hi. Now be nice, because you're not the only show host on air.
That's true.
What I was saying is it puts a lot of pressure on TV networks for something to happen, right? And so when we created the show, I said, well, why don't we make a large portion of the show just looking at what people are claiming, first of all, that is they have as evidence, and decide if it's worth going out, you know? And it really does help, I think, because, you know, half of investigating, as most people know, is doing the research. The actual sitting there in the location can be rather boring. You know, it can be hours and hours and hours of nothing happening, and you just can't have a ghost hunting show with nothing happening or people won't watch it. So, you know, it's great that we were able to have other things to explore that I don't think had been done before.
Yeah, no, that's clear. I know that you do a lot of things with the ufology and things like that too, as well as Dr. Rita, so it's kind of a coincidence I had you both on. You both share some similarities there, and can you tell us a little bit more about your work in that, Ben?
On the ufology stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it was kind of my first love and probably the thing I know more about. I think there's more dates and figures and things that historical, you know, documents, stuff like that there is to know in ufology as opposed to ghost hunting. So I got interested because, you know, like a lot of kids, I grew up in the years of, you know, NASA was a big thing and everyone wanted to be an astronaut. I didn't really want to be an astronaut, but I wanted to explore space and was kind of a nerdy kid. And so, you know, all the books and stuff that I would read were really sciencey. And then, of course, movies, you know, movies at the time, like they are now, or a lot of them are about aliens and, but it was, I don't know, it was the movies were kind of different then, and they, you know, movies like E.T. or stuff.
Yeah, I've got an interest in UFOs, but I'm on the fence, dude. There's so much, you know, how do you get by the negative stuff like blurry imaging, false reporting? I mean, there's so much of it. How do you separate all that and actually dig down into the existence of alien beings? You still there, Ben?
I think we might have lost him, as I heard. It sounded like he cut off in the middle of
I think we lost Ben one of them days. But I guess we can continue with that topic. You know, and I think Dr. Rita can weigh in on this, too. Alien beings, the concept, you know, how do you sift through all that? The false reporting and fake stories and blurry imaging and photos and stuff. How do you get to the bottom of the actual existence of alien beings and the phenomena that's been spread around the world today?
It's really hard, and it's really challenging for researchers because they don't know what to do with it, you know, and you end up spending time. I mean, it's you know, there's this animosity between the ghost hunting people and the UFO people, which I find really interesting, but they both are faced with the exact same challenge, you know, trying to prove something that the only thing you have in hand is circumstantial evidence and witness testimony. You know, in ghost hunting, you're never going to find a smoking ghost. And at this point in time, you know, there's very little, if any, forensic evidence that has come out of the UFO world.
Yeah.
You know, and actually, can I, like, change the subject a second and bring it back to ghosts?
Yes.
and you know, because it's not that I want to talk, but I am going to say in the last 2 years, there has been this huge rise in individuals who think they have entity attachments. Now, some of them do. I don't think a lot of them do. And I'm not understanding what's going on, if the veil is thinning or, you know, something happens, you know, I mean, because stuff happens all the time. I mean, like around me, it does all the time, you know, and then they freak out. And then the next thing you know, they think they have some kind of an entity. And I don't understand what's going on, because I just know that I'm getting slammed with emails and phone calls from people. Well, you know, I was camping and, you know, there was this light that came in my tent and, you know, now I have an entity attachment. And I'm like, okay.
I think that's because of all the shows, you know. There's all these different ghost shows. And I think some of it is because it's a lot more prevalent on TV now. So people are, one, more aware of it, and two, are more willing to assign something that they can't explain to a ghost phenomenon. And I think some of it also might just be that there is an increase.
Yeah, it's almost like, too, you know, they've labeled this we were talking about this the other day. Do I have schizophrenia? Am I hearing voices? Because, you know, it's, like you said, James, there's so much more of it. It's more available to research. And I think a lot of people, when they start feeling bad things, I mean, it's different to act on it. Everybody has those, especially, you know, after you have a baby. You have certain thoughts, and that's normal. And a lot of people don't want to think that they are capable of having certain thoughts that are not, you know, they're not going to be very popular. I mean, usually when I have those thoughts, I immediately go into prayer. But it's not that everyone, there's so many people in prisons right now, and I've wondered that too. You know, is this an attachment, or is there something evil in this person? Do they have schizophrenia? I mean, there's a lot of things, but it's easier to blame it on that, I think, now, you know, other than take responsibility of, I just think, screwed up stuff sometimes. And that's, everybody does. What do you think about that?
That's a good point, because, like, in the psychological field, for example, that's a perfect example of what I'm talking about, is nowadays everybody has bipolar or borderline personality disorder or one of those associated disorders. Everybody, I mean, just so many people have it. I don't think it's necessarily that there's that big of an increase in that disorder. I think the awareness of that disorder has increased. Back in the olden days, when you acted the same way, you were just called an a-hole and or a jerk or whatever, and people didn't like you. But now there's a name for it, so now everybody's, oh, that's why I'm such a jerk, because I have this. You know what I mean? And then they go to shrinks to tell them that they have it. And I think that's a lot.
And then they put them on medication.
Yeah, and then medication, a lot of those psychotropics make you even worse. They make all kinds of crazy things happen. I have a friend of mine who's schizophrenic, and he's real schizophrenic. He's not like, oh, I think I'm schizophrenic. He's like, he hears voices come from the TV telling him to kill people. He's crazy. He's been in and out of the psych ward and everything. He's nuts. And they put him on different medications, and some of the medications make him cut himself. Some of the medications make him bob back and forth like a crazy person. I mean, a lot of these psychotropics, man, you're messing with the brain, and we don't even understand the brain yet. So a lot of them have worse side effects than what they're trying to cure, which to me is crazy and it's scary.
Well, and I think the sad part is that we aren't taught that spirit is everywhere. You know, I mean, I'm not sure I've lived in a house that there wasn't some ghost, you know, and I just won't move into a house that has, like, bad ghost energy or bad mojo energy, as I like to call it, because it would scare the crap out of me. I mean, I bought a house that was built in 1910, and I didn't ever feel anything in it, but I'm kind of a chicken and don't like doing things in the dark. Even ghost chime, nah, turn the light on, it's good. And I joked around because I only had a bathroom that was downstairs, which meant I had to go downstairs to use it. And I said, well, I'm going to get Christmas lights, and I'm just going to string Christmas lights all the way down the stairs and into the other room so, you know, I can go use the restroom in the middle of the night and not put the ceiling lights on. And, yeah. And, but I've never had to use them because I've never been scared here. And I know that there are spirits here because I feel them around me, you know, and actually have names. But they don't bother me. They don't scare me, and we just cohabitate, and we're all good.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't think people realize that that is our reality. And they come face to face, you know, they open up, they access that part of themselves that they've had turned off or not paying attention to, and then they get freaking scared.
If you feed into, you know, like if you have a paranormal phenomenon, you feed into it and you get, I don't know, the more you feed into it, the more amped it can become. We've seen this in many haunted cases and stories, books, novels, lectures, you know, the words. And again, it's my belief that you become intuitive to the aspect of a haunt, of some haunts, whether the residual or whatnot. And I think the more you feed into it, you know, people have false said, well, if you, it's only with the demonic that this works that way. Well, no, it's not. We've seen it in many other cases around the world, in other countries, you know, the works. And so it's really difficult to be able to separate, you know, reality from the super unknown. As you get more acquainted with maybe a particular haunting, your own haunting perhaps, you can get self-indulged so much that you become an everyday fixation with it, and it gets into your subconscious and into your sleep. And we've seen a lot of cases where people, they get involved so deeply that it actually, they become afraid of the occurrences and things, and so that it's a good topic to talk about. I've seen a lot. I've had people come to me and say, hey, you know, Evan, I've got this haunting. I've had it for 10 years, and it's now amping up. And I ask them questions. I say, the first thing I ask them is, how deeply involved are you into this case, or how deeply are you, you know, experiencing the phenomena, and how much are you observing, you know? And I try to get an understanding of how much they are actually involved into this particular phenomenon. And most oftentimes, when these things are amping up and bad things are happening, there's a lot of activity, day and night, residual, whatever, the thing is that these people are kind of bringing it, they're inviting it in by being so in tune with it. So you got to have some sort of on-off switch. And a lot of people say they have this, but a lot of people don't know that they can also be shut out at the same time. What's your thinking about that, Dr. Rita?
Well, I think that you bring up a really interesting point. You know, I mean, I believe that people get entity attachments because they invite them in. You know, they invite them into their auric field, and then they try to control and manipulate who they are, which I think is different than, you know, people that complain of disturbances or scratching or whatever. I don't consider that an attached entity. But anyway, semantics aside, I think it's interesting your point of them getting involved or starting to worry about it, which can bring them in. And I think that that's a very valid point. When I, you know, do speak on ghosts on different shows, you know, one of the things, or entity attachments in particular, I tell people, you know, there are all those books that say, you know, call your angels in and surround you. And I'm like, don't do it. Just don't do it. Because if you're in a bad place, you're scared, you're depressed, you're sad, you know, you're in a bad relationship, if you are in a bad place, you're going to attract to you something that is in a bad place too. And so if you're calling your angels, they might be a little bit brighter than you, but they might not be that good.
That is so interesting. And also, don't you think, when you feel depressed, when you're angry or in a bad relationship, and you have those around you, don't you think they feed off of that negative energy and just, you know, that's like feeding a hungry lion?
Well, what they do is, or what I have observed is that there is usually, this is the agreement, and this is how they attach, okay, which, again, is different from the scratching and whatever, how they attach, is there is some lacking within ourselves or a need within ourselves that is not a healthy need. We might be lonely. We might be afraid. We might whatever. And that's the vibration they'll attach to. And so until you can change that, you can't get rid of it. And so like people that have addiction issues, whether it's drugs, alcohol, gambling, computer, when you get rid of the alcohol, when you turn the computer off and get separation from it, then you can resolve the entity issue. But if you're in the middle of the addictive behavior, that's what it's feeding off of. You know, and so it's kind of two different things. And so if someone has a long history of issues with entities, they really have to look at themselves and say, what is going on in me that's attracting it to me? You know, and I get people and they, you know, they want to schedule a session. I'm like, well, you know, the first session, I'm just going to look at you to see what's going on and, you know, see what the attachment's about. And they're like, well, can't you just fix it? And they don't realize how they really participate in what's going on.
Yeah, and this is a question I really, really want to ask you guys' opinion on. There's so much speculation that the entities that are here with us are in some type of, you know, purgatory, or they've not made peace, and that's why they're here. And, you know, as a friend of someone who, you know, I had a friend last year who came back from the military with PTSD, and he shot himself. And I've always wondered, what happens to people when they commit suicide? Is it something that they are going to be here for a while because they didn't, you know, I guess, are they unsettled spirits, I guess, is what I'm trying to get at. Hello?
I'm not sure if I should talk because I was just talking a whole lot before, so.
No, go for it. Go ahead and talk. I've been trying the show. I forgot I was even a host. I'm like, okay, I'm digging it. I did it. Doing a great job. You really are. Yeah, go ahead and answer that.
Okay.
Dr. Reed, by all means. I mean, it's not every day we get you on the spot, and boy, we're putting you on the spot. Good questions, great answers. It's appreciated.
No, it's a great question, though. As I said earlier, spirits are everywhere. And so there are spirits that have not, you know, crossed over, gone into the light. You know, they wander the earth. But then there's another group, which I think people really need to recognize, and I'm going to come back to your question in a second, is that, you know, when people die and they do go into the light,
they're not
trapped in freaking heaven. There's not a padlock. And they can come visit us. I mean, I remember my ex-husband, we were moving, and there was this man, okay, invisible man, sitting at the kitchen table drinking a cup of coffee.
Uh-huh.
And he looked like my husband. And I was like, if your dad was in the house, would he be at the table drinking coffee? And after a bit of dialogue, he said, yeah, that's where he would be. And I'm like, well, he's here. My late husband comes around me all the time, and I know it's him because when he is in my energy field, I will immediately start to cry.
Wow.
You know, I'll think of him, you know, like his You know, because I can think of him and I'm fine, and then there are other times where I think of him and I just break down and I just feel him just right there.
So you kind of just know when he's present, you know.
Yeah, because I start to cry, and it's like, I don't want to cry, and he stays away from me. I mean, it's sad. He stays away from me because he feels like it's hurting me, you know, and it's like, and I don't mean to cry. It just happens. But anyway,
yeah.
So it's important for people to know that if there's something going on in their house, it might be grandma. It might be dad. You know, it might be your brother that has already crossed. You know, you don't have to necessarily be scared. Okay.
Yeah.
With that said, you know, there are the people that die, that committed suicide, have been in accidents, you know, and have not crossed over successfully. And so sometimes they have to spend time to heal the trauma or to resolve whatever. Sometimes they're waiting for someone. You know, it's interesting. I'm working on a new book. And the section that I've been working on this past week is about ghosts. And it is not just in our culture that has this belief that they don't cross over. I mean, apparently, I will get a little technical here. Apparently, death and burial rituals are all designed to ensure that the person that died makes it to the other side successfully, because their fear was that if it wasn't successful, they would come back and haunt them as a ghost.
Wow.
And this notion goes back thousands of years, and you find it around the globe. Fascinating to me.
Yeah, so if someone doesn't want to be buried and they want to be cremated, for instance, which I do, so it's not really, this was made by people when they were living, this law or rule or whatever it is, was made by people when we were living. So it's really, fascinating.
Well, it's fascinating because it is a worldwide belief, you know, and so to me, there's a level of truth to it, because why would everybody do the exact same thing, you know? But even in those cultures, they had their medicine men and their priests who were often psychics, you know, or mediums, you know, stuff like that. And there are cultures where cremation was their burial ritual, you know, so I don't really see cremation as being, you know, like you're not having the proper burial kind of thing.
I think the idea that the thing that goes bump in the night could be grandma, that concept, as simple as it is really groundbreaking if you think about it. I mean, what an amazing message of love and hope that is,
mm-hmm.
to think that somebody could come back and just visit with their family. I mean, the main thing that most people worry about with death isn't necessarily the pain or the sickness. It's leaving their family behind, not being able to be there for them, not being able to help them. And the idea that you could come back and visit and check up on them, that's powerful. I mean, that's an amazing concept.
Well, and it just makes me wonder if that's where the whole, see, now I'm having like a little epiphany here, because this was part of my ghost thing, was the notion of ancestor worship. And I'm wondering if that is where that came from. You know, where they honored grandma and, you know, these ancestors, because they did have a relationship with them, you know, because they would come visit. Well, I have to write that down, because I need to include that in my book.
Yeah, I know. Like, I'm part Cherokee and part Blackfoot, and I know that in my culture, we get a lot of information from ancestors. And, like, a lot of times you'll go into a sweat lodge and you will get yourself into like a delirious state, and you'll actually communicate with your ancestors. So that really makes me wonder if it's not your real actual ancestor coming back. Because, I mean, that stuff doesn't happen much anymore. That's stuff of the past. But it makes me wonder if if a lot of that might not have been the actual ancestors coming back from heaven or wherever they were and actually really communicating with the people that were there. I mean, it's silly because it's such a simple concept, but it never really even crossed my mind. I mean, that's kind of mind-blowing.
Well, see, and I was just having like a little epiphany on that, but it totally makes sense. You know, one of the things that I find very sad is that ancient and indigenous cultures, you know, you were talking about the Native Americans, were very spiritual, were very connected to the world of subtle energy and all things unseen, you know, and the spirit of the plants and the spirit of the animals and this notion of oneness that we in the 20th century have no regard for and invalidate. And people that look to create that kind of a relationship are looked at like they're crackpots, you know, and we pay a lot of money for somebody to teach us to do something that we already knew.
Yeah. A lot of those traditions are still carried on today. I mean, like, a lot of that is still taught to us. And, like, my first kill, the first deer I ever killed, I had to drink the blood, and there was a whole thing. And so that's still taught, but it, you don't understand really what it means. It's just one of those things that's done because it's always been done, you know? Mm-hmm. And we've lost touch, not everybody. I'm sure there's people that haven't, but a lot of us have lost touch with what that connection really is and what it really means to be connected to all things living. I mean, whether it's a tree or a spider or a fly or another human being, we're all connected. You heard, it's like that thing that's going on with the bees right now, to where the bees are dying off. And if the bees dies off, then a lot of the fruits and vegetables won't be able to be pollinated, and it'll just be a terrible thing. And it really illustrates that we're all kind of in a circle here. We're all connected to each other, and what affects one affects everybody. But we just really don't see that anymore.
Hey, guys, not to interrupt here, but couple minutes left, actually, because we started, you know, about 20 minutes late, so I don't want to cut off without getting our links out there and everything. I just want to send a special shout-out to people involved today. Of course, we all know that it's Deborah Fawcett's birthday. We're wishing her a happy birthday. Enjoy your one day here a year that you're very deserving. Kind-hearted lady. She's the person that's in charge of the Lavaca County Jail. Great place to do for your paranormal research, and what a fine person, fine place, actually. I also want to thank Dr. Rita for coming on, Dr. Rita Louise of Just Energy Radio. She's also a historian and author of several books. Check her out, Dr. Rita Louise, on Amazon.com. You can find
her. Can I throw in one quick thing? Evan?
What's that? Yes, please do.
So, you know, earlier I was talking about my new release of Holy Deception.
Yes.
If people, it's available on Amazon.com, but if they go on Vimeo, because Vimeo actually lets you do cool stuff, and they use the coupon code Dr. Rita, so D-R and then R-I-T-A, Dr. Rita, they can get it for 50% off. So it's $2.99, which is a total bargain in itself, but they can get 50% off for a limited time by going on Vimeo.
That's a smokingly awesome deal. Awesome, awesome. I'll do it. I want it. No, you don't see any better than that. That's another thing is why I really like what you do, Dr. Rita, is because your work, people can buy it, and it's really reasonable. More reasonable than a lot of people's stuff out there. And same with James Hershey, Jimmy LaVore author. He's got several books out there. And so we really appreciate the work that you do and for being on the show today and being with us on short notice. And quite frankly, today was the day that I had a hard day as a host for the show with things not going right and the scheduled guests that I had booked not showing and so forth. And you guys made an amazing show today, came on at short notice, and rocked the show. So I really appreciate it, and I know our listeners appreciate it. It was a good show, and I also want to say thank you to Kelly Griffin. She had this, work around taking care of her kids and a functioning event where she's at an actual ball game. She came on the show. Amazing, amazing job from everybody involved today. It's a real pleasure to have you on and to be a part of what you guys do. And I just want to say thanks on behalf of our listeners and the people that have tuned in today and all that good stuff. With that said, Dr. Rita, keep in touch. We'll have you on again. We enjoy having you on. It's always a pleasure. James Hershey, Jr., his show, Revolution Radio, it's a pretty damn good show. I was on it the other day, had a great time. They're doing a wonderful job for representing the paranormal in fun ways and outstanding ways. And with that said, everybody, again, I want to say thanks for tuning in, for being on the show, being part of the show, and, continue onward with our paranormal journeys and as it takes us in different directions. And with that said, I just want to say again, thank you to everybody and all that was concerned today for the support and love you shared throughout being on our programs and each time. With that said, this is Beyond Reality Paranormal Talk Radio, and it was a pleasure being with you on tonight, and we'll see you here on Thursday, believe it or not. We have a show on Thursday, which is not our normal time, but we will be going to a different day here in a couple days as I meet with Kelly Griffin, and we will talk about that, and we'll address that issue here in a couple days, as we will be appearing with a new time. So with that said, everybody, be well, take care. Thank you again for coming on, and we're out.
Good night.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night now.